This week, three sides of the coin. This is probably our absolute favorite interview we've ever done in over 10 years.
Yep.
We are joined by Timothy Bogart, who is the son of Neil Bogart, and we are joined by Joyce Biawitz, who was co-manager with Bill Aucion of Kiss and then married Neil Bogart. They sit down for nearly 2 hours and talk Spinning Gold, Casablanca, and Kiss.
This is Three Sides of the Coin, talking all things Kiss.
I want to rock and roll all night.
You're listening to Three Sides of the Coin.
Everybody, welcome back to another episode of Three Sides of the Coin. You got all four of us, and we're going to end up having six on this interview. We're not going to do any housekeeping. There's no
Let's
comments.
Let's get this
rig
rolling.
You just want to sit because not only are we joined by Timothy Bogart, who wrote and directed the movie Spinning Gold, and is the son of Neil Bogart, unknown
plus,
at the last moment, we are joined by Joyce Biawitz. Do you know her place in history, people?
And her place in
history. You should. In Kisstory, in Casablanca history.
Oh.
She sits down with us. Tim and Joyce sit down with us for nearly 2 hours and talk about Casablanca and Kiss.
Amazing.
Just let it roll.
Speechless. Yep.
And we're going to see you at the end because we went all fanboy and fangirl over this one. Mm-hmm. But also, don't forget, Spinning Gold, March 31st,
yep,
nationwide. Go check it out. It really is. It's an incredible movie about Neil Bogart.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Subscribe on YouTube. Follow and rate us on Spotify. Subscribe and leave a review on iTunes. We appreciate your support.
Three Sides of the Coin. We're already speechless because this was going to be an amazing interview with Timothy Bogart, who is here. And at the last minute, Tim said, would you like to have Joyce join us? And of course.
Yeah.
So thank you. God. Thank you so much, Joyce, for taking some time out to join us. Thank you, Tim.
Yes.
I think the first thing we have to say, because we've watched the screener of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing.
Love
and,
it.
And we're not saying that to just kiss up because you're on the show. It was an incredible story of Neil. And yesterday I said this to Tim in a different interview. The first thing Kiss fans have to change in their mind is this is not a movie about Kiss.
Nope.
This is not a Kiss movie. They're part of it, but so are many other artists. This is a movie about Neil Bogart and who Neil Bogart was. And once you change that frame of mind, this movie makes so much sense and is so amazing in revealing the person that Neil is. Because I think up until this movie, fans just have this impression of Neil based on maybe what Gene would say, Paul would say, media might say, but I think this really tells who he is as a person.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How brilliant he was.
Well, he says it. He says, no, you know all these acts.
Yeah.
You know, I may not have been as talented as them or mean as much as them, but you know, I made you dance. Well, he did more than that. He really created a soundtrack from Bubblegum and all of those R&B things. And, you know, hey, Charlie Daniels was on Buddha Records. There's so much that, you know, Tim talks about he had to get rid of. This is a sculpture and not a painting, a huge sculpture, and he had to keep carving it out. There's a lot of amazing stories, but I think that the ones that are in there really kind of tell the picture. And that's, you know, that's what the important thing is.
Well, yeah, and go ahead, Tommy.
I was just going to say one of the most interesting things for me as a fan was to see what he was like because I never got a chance to meet him. And I also was really taken by his, how he wasn't just a businessman. I mean, he loved the music and the whole thing surrounding Donna Summer and how you created that, or he created that image, was fascinating to me because I didn't know any of that before.
I don't think anybody, you know, knew any of that. That's the reason, one of the reasons for this movie is.
One of the lines that came out of the movie, and I think it was probably said more than once, and it is really true, is he created the soundtrack of our lives. You know, we were all kids growing up during the 70s. And this is music that we didn't realize back then was going to have such an impact and last forever.
Right. Who would have thought that? What we didn't think about that. We were recording, you know, artists that we believed in, that we were fans of. And Casablanca was not only a family, that we were fans of these people. We appreciated their talent on such an intimate level because we were working with them every day. And they were included in, you know, in the family. Those that left and went to a different record company called me afterwards and went, wait, we thought everybody treated, all the record companies treated us like this, that we were over for Sunday night dinner. And that, you know, I used to show up at rehearsals for Donna at SIR Studios here with Tim and Brad and Jill in tow with their homework. And Jill, while I did rehearsals with Donna, and Jill would, you know, run around in the costumes and the shoes. And this was life. The Kiss would come over for dinner, not with no makeup, just hang out.
Joyce, was it artistic license in the movie or not? I never knew with Bill Aucion. Did you had to fake to be his girlfriend or?
Oh, that's a very big story. And on Monday night, I'm doing a panel with a women's big music industry, women's organization, international.
I'd never even heard that rumor before.
You know, it's going to probably be something that comes up for sure with this group. When I say you were my best, you know, non-boyfriend ever. Yes, Bill was gay when we did production and we did a television show called Flipside. That's how we met everybody. The crew would not have worked with him as a gay man.
Oh.
And he didn't come off like he was a gay man, you know, whatever. He was very smart and funny and fabulous. And so he needed that protection and I needed that protection, literally needed that protection. It wasn't a career that I had or, you know, and I don't think it was because I was such a killer chick. It was because this is what it was. It was the price of doing business back then. And that kind of protected me.
Interesting.
If somebody hit on me and I'd say, oh, Bill, you know, whatever. And they'd go over and they'd apologize to Bill. Bill couldn't understand. He'd say, why are you apologizing to me? Apologize to her. No, we were, you know, we had a really wonderful friendship. We were like brother and sister and really operated like that. There's a scene where in the movie where Kiss is demanding a renegotiation or whatever. And I love that Tim held on Bill's face because what he got was, oh my God, I have just split up this marriage with Joyce. This wasn't, it was personal. And you know it. She says, oh yes, this is not okay. And he knew, but you know, he had to choose the group at that point.
And for Joyce, he had to make that choice. I mean,
Joyce, can you talk a little too about the tensions that were created once Kiss realized their manager was now dating and marrying the record label?
All right. So, Tim, can I blow this one a little out of the water? Because they always knew. I brought the tape to him when he opened Casablanca. So, you know, this was no secret. He and I went to magic places together to get all of their things. We got those dog collars from the pleasure chest next to my apartment in the village. They were, you know, certainly Bill Bill and I did Flipside, and we did television commercials for Neil, and we worked with Neil on all these different things. He knew what was going on. It's wonderful drama for the movie, and it says the resentment that did build up, even though, I was the person who would sit at the agency and wait for 3 hours till they'd give me a check for the next tour and tell them, I'm not leaving. I'm going to go home with you until you give me money. I got to get my act on the road. They realized it, but at a certain point, and they were influenced by others that they needed to, and this happens with so many acts, they needed to take a stand on their own. And that's what they did. Fortunately, it worked out for everybody. Mm-hmm.
Joy, I asked Tim this question yesterday. I'd love to get your take on it. Would Kiss have worked with anybody else other than Neil Bogart or Casablanca?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. As you know, Warner Brothers couldn't stand them. They thought they were ridiculous. They didn't get it at all. And even their agency, ATI, they would say to me, no one will let them open for them, leave the equipment home, take off the makeup. And I kept saying, you don't get it, do you? This is what the kids love. And it's also, the music is great, but this is the whole show. We're into a show now. It's different. Nobody's sitting in their garage playing to their amps. Nobody cares about those people that are doing that.
Do you think some of it though is at the time, maybe a lot of the record people in the business were much older, so they were having a harder time understanding the change?
I think they were having a hard time understanding the whole change from Woodstock on.
Okay.
So many of them there, from the record industry and Woodstock in suits. It's like, where are you guys? What are you doing? I, in a way, I came from a different generation. I was really a hippie. I mean, I was that thing because I was a little bit younger than this crew. Not much, 5 years, 6 years.
That can make a huge difference.
But they were a different generation. Neil was one of the ones who got it. It was like, okay, wait, I see what the youth is into now, what where the music is going, and it's terrific. But that there was a big sea change around then. I mean, I came into the industry though, all the original guys were at their companies. Like Jack Holtzman was at Elektra, and Joe and Mo were at Warner Brothers. I mean, everybody was there. Clive Davis was at Columbia at the time, it's called Columbia. We had them all do things for Flipside. That was a show where the record company presidents hosted. So that's how Neil got involved. He did the pilot, and Florence Greenberg, who for many years, probably 20, was the only female record company president ever in the business, Scepter Records. They did it. But music was changing, and Neil was into it. Look at Curtis Mayfield and Superfly and, all of that.
Yeah.
One of the things that Tim said in the movie, or is in the part of the movie, is something my co-hosts will tell you. I say all the time, I always say, if you don't like Kiss, it's because you didn't listen to them. Uh-huh. And I love that part of the movie, when they're talking about Alive and not having hits, and Neil says, these were great, so you just didn't know it yet. Uh-huh. And then I thought, and I'm like, thank you. That is exactly what I've been preaching my whole freaking life.
Well,
these songs are great.
They are. And you know what? Neil didn't sign them after seeing them. He did sign them after seeing them, but he wanted to sign them when I gave him the tape. He had not seen them. It wasn't about the visual. It was about the music.
Amen. Always. Love that.
So, the film actually, he says that. And, it was about the music. Yeah. I mean,
Was some of it, go ahead.
Sorry, there's one other thing, and we had talked about this the other night. The other reason, the difference today is that people are not giving acts time. When Neil says in the movie, Jeremy Neil says in the movie, I just needed more time for you to hear it. In those days, I think Joni Mitchell had 6 albums out before she was a hit.
Yeah.
People believed in their acts and they stuck with them. you know, when it became so corporate. You know, the other reason that it couldn't happen is there isn't the independence today. An independent vision like Neil's, there's not a lot of room for it that I know of. You know, maybe Evan Bogart can give you a whole other thing because he's right in the middle of it. But they're not giving the same amount of time for an artist to develop, for the fans to develop a connection with them like you had with Kiss. Didn't happen overnight.
No, it didn't.
Listen, we toured that country 4 times before all of you went, oh, Kiss.
Well, I was lucky here in Detroit. You guys, I remember. Yeah.
God.
Yeah, that was, there was something special. Everybody knew about Kiss, you know, it was just the thing in school.
Yes, well, that's really nice. My husband and my dog have just joined the podcast.
That's okay.
Okay.
Well, one of the hello. One of the things I was curious about is I had watched the Bee Gees documentary, and they were saying that they were in the studio and they just kind of happened upon that falsetto thing that was working for them. Was some of that at Casablanca? Where, how did you figure out, like with Donna Summer and Parliament and all these, because they're all different, vastly different acts with different types of music. How was Neil able to look at that and go, yeah, I think this is going to work?
Because each artist was true to themselves, because each one was talented. Each one had a vision that was unique, you know, and he got into that vision with them and worked with them to make that happen. So yeah, it was a company that, you know, it wasn't all disco and it wasn't all rock and it wasn't all, you know, George, whatever George was at the time. But, you know, he's now the most sampled man in showbiz.
Yeah.
And has an art career now. I just saw his art show here at Jeffrey Deitch Gallery. I mean, he's amazing. He's amazing. And that whole crew, Bootsy and...
You know, Joyce, I think one of the favorite, wrote down a whole bunch of notes and quotes as I was watching the movie, because there are so many great lines, many great lines. One of them that really hit me, because I had to go back 2 or 3 times, and I think it sort of explains everything we've just been talking about, was, and I can't remember which character, I think it was Neil who did say this, "We are not wrong, we just haven't figured out a way how to be right."
That's right.
That's Neil.
Yeah, that's Neil. And you needed the time. You know, listen, when we met Donna, we knew what her voice was like. I actually said to her when I first saw her in Munich, you know, "You're in a disco thing now, but we're going to get you a television show. You're going to go to Vegas." She was a major talent. We watched her sing in, we went with her to a show in Amsterdam. It was, I think it was Christmas Eve or something, New Year's Eve. And people were just, she had no orchestrations. Neil had to orchestrate the thing and I had to throw the lights and whatever, but nobody cared because the voice was unbelievable. And then at the end, everybody was standing and screaming for her. And I said, "Do you have any more material?" She said, "No." I said, "Do you know White Christmas?" She said, "Yes." I did 10 times White Christmas and people were not leaving. And I thought, major talent here. Plus she had that something. And that's what all of these acts had. You know, when you see someone with that kind of talent and drive, they kind of glow. There's something about a star that has it. I can't tell you what it is because it's individual for each thing. But in the old days, I used to go and watch the lounge acts in Vegas when Donna was playing there. We had other acts, Beck Davis playing there. They were just as talented. But it wasn't, you know, when Gene walks into a room, or Paul walks into a room, or Donna walks into the room, the whole room stops and goes, boom. There's something about these people. You know, George, certainly, because you can't take your eyes off.
Joyce,
they're very special. There's something special going on there, and Neil could pick up on that in about 2 seconds.
Joyce, what do you think, and what would Neil think of Kiss still doing this 50 years later?
Oh my God, he'd be laughing. Listen, it's amazing, right? Who thought of this? I mean, I got a call from somebody who was doing their thesis on disco and asked me what was the meaning of disco bells? And I thought, come on. But I had to be very nice to them because they were doing their thesis on it. It's the same thing. It's, I mean, I think the music that we made in the 70s, because it had time and because we found these individual people, and also because it was coming off of the 60s where people really found their individuality and we really had something to say, that this music is something special that I don't know that will ever get replicated. Certainly today it's a little more difficult. It's very pop. You're not getting the same, you know, listen, when I remember when FM radio came on, where you could actually play a cut for more than, you know, a minute 36 or whatever it was that was going on. Alison Steele, The Nightbird, yep. New York, you know, it was, we were glued to that. My generation was glued to that because it was like, they had something to say. They were talking for my generation, to quote the song, you know, this was it. And I think that those statements are so clear and they're so real that they're still today. I mean, all of my kids have tried to steal all of my albums over the years. I had to put a lock in. No, Bradley, that's yeah. not record. Stop it. So yeah, no, I mean, it's like, but I think it's amazing that they're still going. Hey, listen, Gene has some kind of tour he's doing right now that you can get in on. I don't know what Paul's doing.
Yeah, it's that thing at Vegas that they're doing. And then he's doing the thing next December.
In England.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Record with him at Abbey Road.
Well, yeah, I love.
Why not?
You know, I think that you're gonna have to take him out by his boots from some studio or some, you know, why not? You know, our good friend Burt Bacharach just passed away. He was still in the recording studio like the week before he died, you know, and he was in the late 80s. For God's sake, these people, they hear the music. They live the music, but the music, it's coming from them and they can't stop it. You know, this is something that's just, that's what it is. And people, and you relate to it, you know?
Let me ask you kind of a deep Kiss question here. So back in 73, did you see Kiss as characters, as people? Because obviously, as we know now, Kiss exists with only Gene and Paul. The other two characters have been replaced by Tommy Thayer and Eric Singer. And there's always been discussion over the years that, sure, why can't you replace Gene and Paul and just continue on with the right attitude? How is that? How did you view that back in the 70s? Was that even a consideration?
Kiss got in touch with us. Bill and I did that show. We had Direction Plus, which was our production company, and we did that television show, Flipside. And they figured out, along with other groups, that we knew every record company president quite intimately in the business. And they called us to come down and see them, you know, which we did. But they didn't look like, you know, this, they had just come off of being Wicked Lester, for God's sakes.
Right.
This was not Kiss as you know it. This was t-shirts and some black fake leather pants and some makeup, but it didn't look like that. They had the idea and they had the logo, which I was very impressed with as a branding person. I love that. But they had the whole idea of what they wanted to do, but that wasn't them. You know, we were clicking people in at the beginning. Oh, look, we got 150 people in the club. But the music was there and the personalities were there. You know, and Gene and Paul were the driving force. I don't think you could replace them and still have Kiss. It wouldn't be Kiss. I don't think. That's me.
Yeah, you know? It's interesting about, you know, that as it relates to how we tried to capture exactly what Joyce was just saying in the movie, is with each one of the artists, we wanted to show their journey to finding themselves. And so, you know, like the conversation we're having about music before we started, and choices in the film, you know, I knew by not having the final 1977, 78 makeup, there's going to be people going, well, that's not right. But I remember Gene telling me vividly, the grease makeup was so awful. It would hit the light, it would melt, and they were constantly trying to figure it out. So we very much wanted to capture how they became who we now know and love. And so in those early years, in that first party in 74, It wasn't all there, and it was t-shirts. It wasn't that. So, and when Gene and Paul helped our design team, they actually generously gave time to the production designer, the costume designer. They were the first ones to say, that's not what it looked like. And we want to show that we were figuring out each step of the way, and to some degree to show how hard they worked, how deeply they believed in finding that vision. But the movie doesn't start where Kiss, you know, becomes. The movie starts at the very origin tale. And exactly what, and all, you know, I get, you know, the movie from all these extraordinary stories from lots of people, but most, you know, foundationally from Joyce. And we spoke about that endlessly, about what it was like, her trying to help him with the makeup in the back room.
Well, here's a couple for you, all right? Because, you know, Paul had that, like, mask on for a while.
The bandit. So
they had to, coming from film and TV and writing and stuff, I said to them, okay, let's do the backstories of your characters. Who are you? They were like, what? I said, no, sit down with, I think, Susan Mineo from PR. Then we sat down and we started to write who is the Catman? Who is the Spaceman? Who are you? What are you doing? You know, you don't have to make it a 25-page thing, but tell me about your character so we can develop that character of who you want to be.
That's brilliant.
Yeah. Also, because, you know, everybody, oh, Gene was, of course, he's the one who spits fire. Really? Well, we had just painted our office. Tim knows this story. We had
This didn't make it in the movie for lots of reasons, but this is a great, tell the story slowly. This is a great story. Okay.
So Bill and I, we had an office with Howard Marks, who was another partner of ours. And we had just had the walls all painted white. It was gorgeous. And we had these great couches and we were like, "Ooh, we have a real office." Anyway, so I had found this guy called Presto, the magician, who could do fire tricks. We had gotten into the flash paper, which Neil, you know, Tim has Neil use all the time, which he did, by the way, that's not made up. And we got all this stuff from Presto. He was on like 47th and Broadway or something. And so we had him come there to show, and he did it. He showed us how to do it. And none of the guys wanted to do it. This is not an easy thing to do. So we looked at them and we said, come on, one of you got to go. And Gene went, all right, I'll do it. So he got up and he did it. And when he was finished, the entire white wall was black. He had scored. Looked at me like, I'm sorry. I said, it's only pain. No, all of those things kept changing. You know, Peter going up on a drum riser for the first time. That's frightening, being up there 10 feet. Can I tell one more story about Peter and the drum riser? It's a great one.
Please.
Please.
Yes, please. We're all ears.
As many as you got.
So we're in, I don't know. We're, let's see, it wasn't Cleveland, but it was someplace around there, okay? And we're in a club, and it was fairly early on. The club holds about 3,000 people, but it was very low ceilings, okay? So it's 3,000 people, and I forget who we were opening for. It was not an act we should have been playing with. When they announced Kiss from New York, the whole crowd booed. I'm with all these promotion people and radio DJs, and they're all looking at me, and Neil's going, nice. I thought, okay, great. So they play the set. By the third song, this crowd is going nuts. All they want is Kiss. They don't want the closing act. They want them to keep going and keep going. Peter goes up on that drum riser. The flash pots go off. And unbeknownst to us, Peter falls off backwards off of the drum riser because he passes out from all of the smoke. Thank God behind him was Junior, this enormous road manager that we had, who caught him, opened up the back walls and put him outside there. But now the crowd is going crazy. They're shouting, they're screaming, they're stamping. And Neil's looking at me, he's like, where is your group? And it's usually Bill who was backstage there, and I was out front doing whatever with the audience and the promo guys. And now I'm making my way through this crowd. Finally got there, and there's Peter like gasping for breath. I said, you got to get up. You have to do it encore. Sorry, guys. Get up. Get back.
Oh, that's fantastic.
We lost him. We had a couple of those things where we almost lost the members of the group or the group in the lawsuit before we even started because of all that pyrotechnics. Ooh, dangerous.
The flash paper thing, what show was that? That was that where Gene got that in the kid's face?
Oh, I don't know if we want to talk about that because that kid may be hearing this. He's still coming. Not my problem anymore, but gee. No, it was, yes, it was, well, it was New Year's Eve.
That was it. Oh, God. Academy of Music?
At the Academy of Music. It's like 8 freaking o'clock. I mean, and I'm there with kids who are throwing up already in the bathroom. And I'm thinking, I'm a grown woman. What am I doing? But once again, I'm in the audience and Bill's on the stage and it's going well. Everything's great. And then Gene throws off one of these things. It wasn't even, we had like flash bombs. It wasn't even flash paper. It was like, it's supposed to go up in the air and go, woo. And it hit this kid in the face. Well, we were calling attorneys. We were giving him all kinds of Kiss merchandise. The group was me. We got a doctor from, he was fine. He really wasn't. It was like more of a little kind of burn. But I said to Bill, oh, good. We're done before we even start. It's over now. I think we opened even before the Dolls. We were so low on the totem pole that night. I don't even remember who you probably.
The name's not, their name wasn't even on the.
No, I'm telling you, it was like, I can't believe we're doing this. This is where I am New Year's Eve.
Tim, can you and Joyce talk about the song Beth and how the movie is portraying the story and the origins of Beth? Because as Kiss fans, that doesn't go with the Kiss version of Beth. That makes sense.
Oh, who believes them? Listen. No. I mean, have you read all those books? I haven't, but I mean, because I read them and I go, really? Okay. Anyway, no, that is the version of it. Peter wrote it for Lydia.
Yes.
Lydia is not a good song thing. Lydia, I hear you calling. So, no, they changed it to Beth, and they probably did it with a little, you know.
But Gene has said often and loudly, you know, how no, the whole song, the song was always Beck. And then
right.
made fun of Peter going, you know, it sounds like you're in love with Jeff Beck. But it really was Lydia. That's where Peter wrote it. And my conversation with Peter over the years about all this stuff, what was really important about this story and what I really strive to do in the movie was provide everyone, a love letter and a real entertaining, flashback to a time. But for those people who had a real connectivity to these characters in this moment, to give them something new and to give them something they hadn't heard. And certainly knowing the Kiss fans, I always thought that song that changed their history, mm-hmm. was critical to finally tell right. And I know that it was something that Peter carried with him forever about the fact that Gene and Paul hated that song. They hated that song. They said, we will never put that song out. It doesn't sound like Kiss. We're not going to do it. They made fun of Peter incessantly. And then my dad ends up getting the strings in the recording session. They don't even go to the recording session. They thought it was a joke. They didn't like it. And then, of course, the fact that it becomes the song that changes everything, ultimately. And I get why they have written history to embrace that moment as their own, but it was not their own. It was the furthest from their own. It was the song that changed everything that uniquely was not of Gene and Paul. Matter of fact, it was quite the opposite. And that was really important for Peter to finally have that story told. As a filmmaker and a storyteller, I thought that was important for Kiss fans, but I also thought it was important to understand, the larger context of who that band was and what those interactions were. And we all know that ultimately Peter, does some things in his personal life that become justifiable for why that band perhaps couldn't have gone on the way it did. But some of that antagonism happened earlier between the guys. And I think history or Kisstory has sort of been written that it was the substance abuse and that's really what it was. And I don't think that's the whole story. And so, we really wanted to tell that story. That was important. The fact that they changed it to my mother's name when, this relationship was going on, That's what happened, but it was not Beck.
So when Neil heard it and it was Beth, he truly was like mad that they were writing a song singing about her? Because that's how I interpreted it in the movie.
Well, in that moment of his life, I think it was the transformational choice of which life am I going to have? And I think it was quite clear that, you know, the love story that had begun with Joyce was that story. That wasn't the end of my father's relationship with my mother. I mean, I think that it was really ended long before that, but I think those moments, you know, to be able to illustrate that dividing line of his life was the past and this was the future. And, you know, that song, in addition to the fact that Gene and Paul were just not really supportive of it, you know, we did draw at all. I didn't want it on the next album. And each one of those albums kept failing to get that radio play, which at the time, there was no success without the radio play.
Right. They didn't understand from a rock ballad.
No.
We would try to give them things, you know, that could be an example of what they could write for rock. And all these other groups had rock ballads. That's how they got known.
Joyce, who's, you know, because this is kind of a two-parter. I wanted to ask both you and, you know, Tim and yourself. Of course, though, you know, Joyce, you were there. Dress to Kill, having Neil produce it. The Kisstory says that he just needed to keep the guys close because they were having contract issues. Can you elaborate a little bit on that? And then part two is whose idea was it to get Ezrin?
Oh.
So Neil producing Dress to Kill, and then how did you get Ezrin after Alive?
Here's the thing. He thought he could produce them so that they could get radio play. This was really about him working with them. It wasn't because he just wanted to keep the group close. That wouldn't have been a thing.
Well, I mean, because that's what we've been told.
Well, that's why I said, okay. So, I really think I can take these songs and make them, you know, what he does with the Isleys, ostensibly in the movie, that he kicks up this sound and he takes this sound away, this sound like, that's what he wanted to do with Kiss. He wanted to produce it to do that. I do not remember, quite frankly, where the crossover with Ezrin. I don't remember that. I'm sure there was some kind of kerfuffle that went on with that, but it's not in my brain anymore.
Well, I now see, especially because the production value was so different. I mean, because Hotter Than Hell was just, it's still to this day, don't worry, I love the songs, but that's a brutal mix. I mean, Neil brought, you could certainly hear, you know, that everything was a lot brighter, it was a lot poppier, the guitar sound, you know, just everything.
Where he wanted to take it, you know, and I'm sure at some point there was a discussion about that not happening. And then they brought in the second crew. You know, it didn't. The interesting thing is that only Kiss Live broke them. But, you know, the reason it broke them, it wasn't just because, we got the sound, which they did. It was because they had toured so many times to these cities over and over again that when kids saw Kiss Live, I was there. I'm going to buy that record. You know, it was brilliant, actually.
Well, you know, I was one of those kids because I have older brother and older sister. And again, you know, I was 10 in 75, but us elementary kids knew who Kiss was. A lot of us had older brothers. And here in Detroit, man, they were front page news. That was a big deal. And I remember when my older brother got Alive when it came out, had Hotter Than Hell when it came out, had Dress to Kill. That was like stuff we listened to. It really was, because I talked to a lot of fans. They're like, wow, we didn't really start getting Kiss until, you know, Beth. And I'm like, God, here in Detroit, they were on the radio.
You know, Cleveland, Toledo, all the places that we would tour. All the time, even in Canada, we had a whole series that we would play up there, you know, the audiences were great. They just loved them. I mean, once they saw them live, they were fans. You know, I'm still a big believer in touring. You want to You want fans out there. Get out there and meet them and meet and greet afterwards and do, you know.
And no matter how much, no matter how much the music industry has changed, you still have to tour. You still have to go out there and go face to face with your fans.
Well, a lot of younger bands want to meet people. They want to meet their fans. So at least that's good, because for a while it felt like bands didn't want to deal with that at all. And I'm not talking pandemic, just in general. The meet and greets have become much more popular.
Oh yeah. And I think with the way that people are becoming, listen, people are doing all these things independently now. They're going, they're getting their music recorded and pressed and put out there and their merchandise put out. I mean, so this is another era where the fans are going to be very, very important, you know?
And it's crucial for the longevity. I mean, the difference is those acts who had that song of the summer, and we don't remember the name of the act, we only remember the song, because they never made that relationship with the audience. And ultimately, I think when you look back at what Joyce and my dad did, I don't know that you can find any other label where the relationship with the fans were not just focused on, but so clearly understood that that was everything. You know, Parliament exists because of the experience of hearing them live and being there. Yes, you can then listen to a radio, but you have to experience Parliament to experience Parliament. You have to experience Donna to experience Donna. And I think they knew that better than any label, I thought, in history up until that point.
Joyce, I want to ask you, being that you're so close to Bill, Sean Delaney, how can you speak of Sean, you know, in some Sean detail, especially early on?
Sean was how we were going to go from production to management business, because Sean was a rocker, you know, he had his whole attitude and the songs and whatever. And, you know, he and Bill were very much in love, and Bill wanted to help him with his career. So when Kiss kind of came along, it was kind of a natural for us to go, well, okay, we could do this. We could get into, you know, my era, I had like four different careers before I was my daughter's age now. I mean, it was different. You could strike out in something that you wanted to do. And really, if you had the vision, and it was so much easier, you know, living was cheaper. Bill and I started a company. I was on unemployment. I was making like $90 a week. I was on somebody else's couch, you know. All those stories about Bill touring in torn sweaters and you know, Gene's mother used to call me, does he have a sweater? I said, he's going to be fine. He'll be fine. I'll give him a sweater. And they'd come with shopping bags, and I would buy them suitcases. I couldn't afford to buy them, but I'd buy them. So, I mean, we were all broke, but who cared? This was, you know, we had nothing to lose, literally. Literally nothing to lose. We were just going to go with this vision till we couldn't, you know. Look, we were all, including Neil, we were all really hung out there. Nobody had, we were taking money, Bill and I, from our production company. Not a good thing to do. And, you know, I will pay the editor. No, I'll put this into Kiss. We were really playing it very close to the vest. And thank God they broke when they did.
Let me ask both of you. So the impression I got from the movie was more that Donna Summer saved Casablanca, not Kiss Alive.
It all happened. I mean,
at once.
Yeah.
The one thing that didn't save them, you know, Neil was amazing. And I speak to this group of young women, I'm going to talk about how he really had faith in women. I mean, he had department heads who were women. This is not a thing that ever happened. So he wanted to do this Johnny Carson album. And he said to me, come on, you're a producer, go produce this album. Yes, I produced the album that shipped gold and returned platinum. That's why I'm still as a producer in the Grammy Association. But he just had ultimate faith, like, go and do this and let's see how the album was great. There's nobody was ready to do it, you know, nobody wanted to hear it. as Tim had him say, you know, the worst thing is having to believe in something because you have to, not because you do. You know, I had kinescopes. You know, nobody had the original stuff from this. It was hours of screening this. When you see her with that little reel-to-reel, and, you know, and she says to him, maybe you should slow down. He says, maybe you should speed up. That's what she's doing. She is putting together the course and album.
But I think also to that point, I don't think, and Joyce, correct me if you think I'm wrong, but I don't think if it was just Donna, the world would have changed. And I don't think if it was just that Kiss Alive album that the world changes, that everything that you guys had been right about from the start, which is why I say we just needed enough time for you guys to catch up to us, meaning right. Joyce and Dad.
True.
I think everything that they envisioned was right from the start, maybe with the exception of Johnny Carson, but even that was a great album. So I don't even think that historically was a bad idea. If you really look at the body of work of what Joyce and my dad created and the other fabulous executives there, they were right. And that's kind of one of the reasons I played with the timeline that way, is I wanted the audience to keep going back and go, yeah, he was right about Ron Isaac. Okay. He was right about Gladys. He was right. And I know that he's going to be right about why is that not happening? So suddenly the biopic becomes a bit of a mystery, but I think, if it all happened at the same time, I don't think that explosion of success, which became unique in the music historical space, could have happened. I think it required both of them. And then, you know, Parliament was right there as well. You know, I mean,
and then the disco acts. So we had the first disco promotion department. We had 25 people running around with the clubs. It was an enormous explosion. It was.
Would you typically start with like the clubs if you had a 12-inch single? Is that when you were trying to break the disco? Was that the first place to go, is to go to the clubs?
Well, yeah, because we had that whole, well, first of all, you know, the great and true story about, you know, WBLS playing Love to Love You. It's true. But when that long playing, at first, it was the first long playing single like that ever. Neil invented that. When that hit the clubs, that record was gold within 2 weeks. It went boom, like that. It was insane. They just played it all night long there. And from that, little by little, everybody and every artist wanted to do a disco album there. So Cher came to the label because she needed to be reinvigorated and did, song is, I'm missing it at the moment, but and Barbara did the song with Donna, Enough is Enough, that Paul DeBarga, I mean, everybody wanted to do disco because that was the big thing. So we had that, and we had all those other acts that were, you know, making it across the platform. Tim's right, the explosion was enormous. One of the things I'll never forget is opening the trades and seeing the ad that we had made. I think it was Warner Brothers was first, and then Casablanca was second. Little Casablanca was second in gold and platinum records.
That had to make some of the other.
Said, we're gaining on you.
Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure I have a trade ad in my collection.
I wish I could find that damn ad. It's somewhere, probably.
Mark's probably got it.
I'm not kidding. I think I have that in my.
We're gaining on you. Well, text it to me, will you? Because
I will.
Loved it. But the little engine that could. Here we are with all, what did Tim, did you call them all like the broken toys?
Yeah, the island of misfit toys. I always really thought that's exactly what Casablanca was.
And that must have bothered some of the other record executives and companies.
Nope. Them.
Because that.
Especially the ones that said they couldn't do it to begin with. You know? Mm-hmm. You
know? Well, that's another thing I wanted to ask you, Joyce. God, there's so many questions that, you know.
You can call me later if you want.
You may not want that.
what other labels? What other labels were you know right around Kiss Alive when the band was starting to, you know, fracture from Neil or want, you know, when everything was going down? What were some of the other labels that were coming to you guys
that wanted Kiss?
And what kind of offers, if you remember, that they were?
No, you know what? Because in 1975, I left Rocksteady management and moved out and married Neil. So I wasn't involved in a lot of those post offers. And the thing is, when he left, of course, they had, because we put it there, a key man clause in their contract, which meant that PolyGram had to renegotiate their contract with them. They did very well by that.
Oh, yes, they did.
You know, unfortunately for Donna, and God bless her, I will always love her, but I tried to tell her when she, you know, we had that whole bad stuff with lawsuits and stuff, and I kept trying to say to her, meet with me without your attorney, because I couldn't tell her you have a key man clause. What idiot is not seeing this in your contract? But also, she didn't know he was leaving. And once he left, she was free. Or she would have been.
One major Kisstory event that you didn't touch on in the movie are the Kiss solo albums. Can you give us some insight from your side of that? How did that come to be? You know, what was going on?
I think, you know, listen, you've seen a lot of artists, I'm sure, and you know that they have individual egos. I mean, look at the Beatles, for God's sake. Everybody wants to be a creator that they think their vision is what needs to be there. And I think that's one of the things that, you know, it was like, okay, we'll do that. We'll do that for you. Let's keep you happy. Let's, you know, keep you creating and doing this. I don't remember the specifics of it, but I know that was a large part of it. It was like, you know,
the fan side of things, that's another one of those moments where it was like, oh yeah, these shipped platinum and returned double platinum because they didn't sell nearly to the level they were hyped.
Well, yes. And they weren't, for me, as good as what the band was together. You know, that happens a lot, I think. Don't you think? What was your opinion of that? Did you like them?
Purely as a fan, I thought Paul's and Ace's were amazing. They were about as close to a Kiss album as you could get.
Yep.
Gene, I was like, is this a demon? And Peter, I was just like, what? Now I understand what he was doing, but as a teenager back then, I was like,
yeah, no,
this is not Kiss whatsoever. What is this stuff I'm listening to?
I liked it. I thought it was a great record. The Gene was the only one I didn't really care for. But for us as Kiss fans, it was exciting to go, okay, we're not going to buy one Kiss record. Now we get four new ones.
Right. I'm sure your parents were thrilled.
Oh, I had to cut a lot of lawns, man.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I remember that vividly.
We earned it all because my mother's just like, why are you wasting your money on this garbage? Like, this is coming from someone who likes to listen to polka music. Yeah. Okay.
Tim, I wanted to ask you something that I was shocked not to see in the movie, you know, towards the end. No mention of Boardwalk or Joan Jett.
Well, you know, similarly, you know, maybe a different level of artistry or quality. No mention really other than a quickie on YMCA and the Village
People. Yeah, well, that's true.
So, which was, you know, I made a decision early on, and as a storyteller, I think it's the right decision. And we'll see what other people think. And, you know, Joyce and I discussed this a lot when I was developing it. You know, I believe as a storyteller, third acts are where most films go to die. They just are. You're trying to wrap something up and suddenly you're going, well, let's show what they learned. Let's show what the cautionary tale was, or let's show what, and every music biopic you've ever seen, for the most part, starts at the beginning. Someone's got this great talent. They have this rise and they all end up with some sort of metaphorical needle in their arm. And that's the lesson that we need to learn and take away from that. And I always thought, which is a very kind of tricky thing for a filmmaker to set out and do this. I always thought this was a movie where I don't know that the main character learned something. And I actually don't think the main character learned something. I think the main character confirms something. And so that's a very different thing. And normally third acts are about what did we learn and how did it play out. But I also wanted to capture for the audience how rapid and shocking his loss was. And so, you know, there was conversations Joyce and I had over the years with other people that we were talking about doing the movie with, you know, like, when are you going to do him in the hospital? And when are you going to do him with the disease? I'm like, that's not the movie I'm remotely interested in telling. Yeah. I'm so interested in this guy who had this extraordinary journey that got cut off. And the perseverance of that journey was ultimately confirmed in this sort of, you know, confessional that he gives to, because to me, the whole movie really is, you know, spoiler alert, you know, guy, end of his life, shows up at the pearly gates, you know, in heaven. And they're going, oh, no, not you. You're the sex drug. You're the wrong guy. You did that thing with Donna. You forced her to be more sexual. You maybe, you know, didn't, you know, pay as much as you should have to kiss. And the movie's about him going, yeah, okay, but let me tell you why. And let me show you this other part of it. There's two sides of that story, or three sides of this, of the coin, right?
So, right.
So once I knew that that's what I wanted to capture with the film, it was early on that I said, "There, the moment that he is confirmed to have been right is the moment we have to say, chop his legs off at the end. And if I think if we went even into the song of YMCA, what I had built to that moment, I think would have been diluted. And I think it would have dissipated. And so even when you sort of then you start talking about there's another, you know, year or two of extraordinary, we could have gone to Casablanca Records and Filmworks. Like we could have gone, there's so many other things we could have gone, and certainly to Boardwalk. But to me, it really was the celebration of this man's vision and the confirmation of his vision and the impact he had on all of us today as a son, as a husband, as a music maker for everyone. And so for him to reach the end of that story and say, did I matter? I think he's just on his own been answering that for himself and not for us. I think he's been wrestling the whole movie, go, did I matter? I did matter. And his last line, which I think is an affront to every storytelling rule in the world, is I wouldn't change a fucking thing.
Loved it.
That's the worst thing you could do in his character that he didn't
think,
but I honestly enjoys you to be better. No,
He would never have changed a damn thing. And there's a couple of things in the movie. People are so fascinated with the music and stuff. But you notice he dances with his daughter on the worst day of his freaking life.
That was touching.
Yeah,
I know.
It says to you, I'm a family man, and this means me. And when I have to leave my kids, you now get how horrible that was for him and what that was about. I love that it's told by him. It's such a, it makes it so personal for you in the audience. You are now on this ride with him, ride or die, man, you're on this ride. And when he hits you at the end, because most people don't know this story, but I was sitting next to Evan at the screening the other night, and the minute he gets to this, Disco died, and we grab each other's arms because we both start to cry. It's this really emotional moment for both of us because we know what the next statement is.
Yeah.
You know,
I gotta admit, I had tears in my eyes watching
it. Me too. Oh,
yeah.
Right.
That narrative was so well done at the end. Oh,
why take it out on that kind of thing? You know, he's now singing his last dance, right? And now you see everybody from that time saying this was the greatest time of our lives. Because I don't know if Tim talked about this earlier, but everybody he ever spoke to said the following things. It was the most incredible time. I don't know if I could do it again. I don't know if I could do it again.
There's also the other one, the quote, which actually gave Clive Davis too, was, don't know how I survived it. Don't know if I do it again. Greatest fucking time of my life. And capturing that song at the end, which my brother Evan, Joyce's son, wrote so beautifully, and then integrating all those extraordinary songs that were the sum of his life and made it the greatest time of his life. That was ultimately the story. So there's no question, Joe Jett, great story. By the way, Night Ranger. I mean, there's so many places you could go, but I felt he had confirmed for himself if there was any question of whether he belonged going through those gates, I think he reached that point and said, yes, and fuck you if you don't think so. About changing the goddamn thing. And let the audience ultimately decide, do I like this guy for that? But to me, that was a very powerful statement about just life. I mean, nothing to do with music or just to me, you know, you get one of these things and lives, I mean, and you really can't spend it kind of regretting or doing something differently. And certainly when you get to the end of it, you don't get a do-over. And that really, you know, I was saying some the other day, you know, as a filmmaker, when people would ask me, what do you want, you know, people to walk out of this movie theater? I always had this absurdly naive, precious response. And every time I would say it, I felt stupid saying it, but I actually meant it. And I would say to people, you know, when I walk out of 99% of the movies I see, the credits end, I get up and we turn to each other and, you know, whoever I'm with and go, where do you want to eat? There's really not a conversation about the thing, right? And I think that that's a very sad thing, especially in movies that are communal experience. You know, you want to talk about the thing, but very movies leave, few movies leave you with that. So when asked what I wanted people to do, first of all, I wanted them to be crying a little bit so they understood that this was a very serious, you know, loss of this incredible person. But I wanted them to be dancing while they were crying up the aisle. And what I really wanted them to do is kind of either say to their person with them or to themselves, Jesus, he did all that in 39 years. What the hell did I do? I better wake up tomorrow and make it matter, like he said. Now, I thought that was a precious, you know, kind of naive thing to hope that. I will tell you, I went to the first actual public-facing screening. There weren't industry people. It was just a recruited screening in Lincoln Square Theater here a couple nights ago. And I ended up doing like an impromptu Q&A. I went just to go, hey, thank you. And nobody would leave. And so they could ask a question. So I just, you know, there's no moderator. It was just me up front. I didn't have a microphone. I was talking loudly. And it just went on for an hour with people just, well, tell me about this, tell me about that. But after that, when I said, we have to leave the theater because there's another movie coming in, but 25 people came down and stayed, not to talk about, well, this was my favorite album and I went to this concert and I love that. People literally, I swear to God, saying, I was going to quit my job. I'm not going to. You know, I was thinking of doing this other career. I'm actually going to. And thank you for that. And just knocked me out.
That's remarkable.
That was what I actually set out to do with no expectation that I could ever do that even with one person. And here was like 25 people who were just there to, they didn't want to let that moment go. And then they started to talk to each other about shared stuff. And ultimately the theater people kind of really did kick us out. But that's his message. And ultimately I think that's his impact. He just made us dance. He sure did. But that's meant he made us live. He sure did.
Right.
Well, and I'm curious. So, go ahead.
No, you know, there's a note that he wrote that said, don't feel badly for me. I've lived more in my short little life than most people live in 100 years.
Yeah.
And The way he felt about it, and that was true, the man went for broke, you know, and everything that he did that he believed in and he enjoyed. This was not a worrying person. This was like, let's do it, you know? Oh, it's another day.
Joyce, before we came on, I was telling Tim.
Yeah, I was just going to say, Mark, I have to tell her that line.
Yes. This is a conversation I had with, I've been fortunate, I've met Peter a few times. And one time when we were talking, Neil came up and I asked him about Neil. And he said, Neil Bogart would bet $1 million to win 100. That has stayed with me.
10 hands. And you see it in the movie a bit. He had, you know, he would take two blackjack tables and play them all at the same time, smoking, sweating, and being excited. And I stand there and just laugh. I thought, okay, let's see how I'm up 10, I'm down 20, I'm up. It was fun for him to do that. And you got to be a very special person to be able to deal with that.
That had to have been wonderful to be around somebody who has that much joy and gusto for life. Mm-hmm. That's what I think people miss in their lives. Just that, yeah. I'm going for it. I love that. And he that was when he kept smiling over the movie. I'm like, that's awesome.
He was a Pied Piper. He was definitely a Pied Piper. People followed him everywhere, because that's the way. Come on, let's go.
Fearless. You know, just
do it. Yeah. Let's do
it. Which is amazing.
And also with people, like if the guy from the mailroom came to him and said, I have this idea. And he would say, all right, so tell me, give me a short thing on that. Sorry, turning my phone off. Give me a short thing on that. And all right, so what would we achieve? How much would it cost? How much could we lose? Okay, do it. And the guy from the mailroom would go, me? He'd go, yeah, it's your idea, isn't it? Here, work with so-and-so, go do it. That's how quickly he made those type of, you know, and I was the perfect foil for him because I'm the ultimate optimist. I wake up every morning, let's see. What can
let's
we
do it.
Today? Yeah, no, I'm always a glass is more than, way more than half full. It's just blowing over.
Love it.
But don't you, you have to kind of be that way.
That attitude gives you, you know, we are very much what we put out there. Mm-hmm. You know, when you talk about perception as everything, you know, if you say Donna's a star, and you dress her like a star, and you get her, and you get her a house like, and you get an agent, she's a star. You know,
yeah.
You know, if you say Kiss is the best rock and roll band ever, they're the demons of rock. She's the first lady of love. You know, you have to be there and believe it and live it. And if you do, other people come along. It's really interesting. Like, come on.
And the artist has people are to looking. Believe it too, right? And the artist has to feel that way. You know,
it's got to come from the artist first.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
but the people are looking for something to believe in.
For the artist's vision and your vision. Well, listen, the record company always wants another album and another hit. Mm-hmm. They're the ones who were, at those days, they were the bank. They were giving you the money to do it all. You know, and so they needed, if they put 10 out there and one or two hit, that was good. But you had to have those one or two hitting or you were out of the game. So you were always asking the artists for more, you know, and also maybe talking to them about what kind of record they were going to put out. And sometimes those visions did not come together, you know, and if you were lucky, you did.
Is that what drove Kiss to record early in their career an album every 6 months? Was Casablanca going, we need more?
You betcha. Also them, they needed to keep getting product out there if it wasn't, you know, sure.
And also exposure too. I mean, you lagged too long in between that time period, that it's going to just be longer until, you know, that longer span for people to see you, you know.
Right. How did you feel about the Hotter Than Hell album? It's my personal question.
I love the songs. Don't like the production.
Songs are amazing. The production was lacking.
Yeah, songs are fantastic.
That was the visual of it was
oh yeah
amazing. The cover, the everything was just
I did that. But I did it with Norman Seeff, who's one of the most incredible rock photographers.
Amazing.
Ever. Yeah. So yeah, Norman and I had a good time doing that.
I always feel that there's a story there behind the whole cover. There's a story there. And we have little bits and pieces of it, but there's a huge story. You know, there's got to be. Big time story.
I don't think the guys were very happy with the cover and the whole look of it or whatever. That was
Chris, I thought it was cool.
Me too.
Art department did that with the design. We talked about it, you know,
yeah.
A lot of things coming.
There's a great photo of you with the band, Joyce, you and Bill from that session for the cover.
With Neil also? They were all like...
No, I don't know if Neil... Yeah, I think maybe... I know you're definitely in one of the pictures.
Yeah.
That looked like a crazy day.
That's what I mean.
any shoot with Norman Seeff was a crazy day. The one shoot that... And Tim has pictures of it in the credits.
Right.
We did a shoot that was like, we all had costumes on. I had like a fur thing, and people had, and Neil had a turban. I mean,
but also, if you look closely, it's not just Joyce. My mother's also in those photos. His parents, my father's parents,
yeah,
and they are equally insane in that photo.
And there are naked women
all over my grandfather. Yeah.
On Al's back, there's this woman, she's got like, and Ruth is looking at him and the breasts are there. It was a craziest shoot. And for years we hid those. I mean, I have the negatives here. For years we hid all of these. I mean, now who cares, right? But
right.
But But then it was like, I don't know that this should come out. We're already being banned in Boston. Well, that really helped, actually. Right?
Yeah, I thought it was great.
Tim Joyce, you know, and honestly, we could talk for so long here. You've already been here for 90 minutes, so I don't want to monopolize all your time. But maybe as a final question, what do you guys each think is the most misunderstood thing about Neil?
Okay. For me, it's the drugs. Okay. And I'm going to, Tim, I'll let you vamp. I want to find Bruce Sudano's quote. You know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
That will tell you. You have to find it.
I was just going to say, I think, and this really comes out of perception in general from people who didn't know him, and as you guys talk about too, who don't necessarily get the music perhaps and have a very limited vision of what that music is. Like, people just don't get Kiss and don't acknowledge that you can't go for 50 years if the songs aren't that fucking good, or that disco was somehow a fad and it's still playing today in any club that you go to.
Right, well, disco became dance in about 2 seconds.
Right, or forgetting that it's the same guy who gave us Midnight Train and these other songs. So I think the ultimate misunderstanding is he's so easily, just like Kiss is easily relegated to being a gimmick, I think he and Casablanca and the work that Joyce and everybody did there could easily be dismissed as surface, as non-important, and as a crazy drug-addled place that was reckless with money. And I think what I try to accomplish here is he was an artist. he may not have achieved being an artist, but he was an artist. And so in different ways, from, you know, the idea of how the origin of a song, you know, happens with someone like Gladys, to how in a recording studio can turn something from something to something else.
Which was interesting to me.
Yeah, to me, I think it'd be interesting to a lot of people, but I think ultimately, he was an artist. And you can make fun of this music, but he's the guy who you know, gave you the gospel crossover, the pop gospel crossover. He gave us, you know, bubblegum music. He gave us, you know, folk music. He gave us disco. You Charlie can't Daniels. Then relegate him to one
Charlie thing. Daniels was Charlie Daniels,
but you can't then relegate him to a thing. You have to suddenly step back and go, anybody who did all of that was a visionary unparalleled. Mm. Was a showman unrivaled. I think ultimately, I think the big misunderstanding is that time, that place, that excess that certainly did occur could so easily diminish the artistry and the skill. And I think this man was unparalleled.
Okay, yeah. The other thing is that time where it was that wild and crazy was such a short period of time.
Mm-hmm.
It was a couple of years. It was not. They make it like it was the whole thing. So I'm going to read you. This is from Bruce Sudano, because Donna's husband, who was in Brooklyn Dreams, who was on Casablanca. It says, Neil Bogart was a visionary. If he believed in an artist and the record, there was no stopping him. He would find a way. He didn't take no for an answer, and he thought outside the box. So much is made of the excesses that went on during this period in a Casablanca, but it was always about the music, and it was all driven by the passion and brilliance of Neil.
Matt. Wonderful.
And I had one last question for Tim. Being that this is such a personal project for you, I'm always fascinated with filmmakers, because you could have played this many different ways. And you explained earlier why you did what you did, but how did you get to that place? How do you get rid of the noise and go, okay, this is the direction I'm going to take, and then you achieve that? Do you see it in your mind's eye ahead of time, or is it like walking down a dark set of stairs where you just see the next one and you know there's a bottom, but I'm just going to keep going till I get there?
I'll tell you, I think it's both, and I'll tell you why. From the very beginning, And in the very earliest stages, you know, this was stuff that as I was developing it, I couldn't have developed it without Joyce. I mean, you know, we talked about this. We talked about what stories were important. And I don't mean just as, you know, someone who had, you know, a Wikipedia resource. I mean, someone who had a great story sense as well. And most importantly, a sense of who these human beings were and why they matter. That was important education for me. But once I started to think about what story I thought was worth telling, it was also through a filter of Joyce and I sort of collectively having heard so many offers to get the rights about other people's visions of the stories they wanted to tell. And it's not that we tried to whitewash, you know, any of the excesses. And I've said repeatedly, I think a lot of my father's flaws were his superhero powers. And I think without being a gambler and an addict, there's no success. Mm-hmm. So I thought the complicated human being was important. I thought, ultimately, the story about this guy who was a cipher for many, who was lost to history for many, I thought and hoped and believed ultimately he would be equally as important. But the most important thing that I thought that was kind of a compass for me, a great lover of biopics, I could never be Ray Charles. I can't play like that. That's a God-given thing. I could never be Aretha. I don't have Aretha Franklin's voice. If I fought hard enough and believed deep enough, maybe I could be Neil. I thought he turned up sort of the human capacity to another level, but I think he did it in a way that was something I think we all could relate to. And there was a universality to that kind of person that was not unattainable. His successes and certainly were something that are unparalleled and all the rest of that. But as a human being, he made choices. He believed in those dreams and he fought harder than anybody else. So if I wake up the next day and decide I'm going to fight harder than anybody else, maybe I can get at least a taste of that. So I started with that. And then, and I've said this before, which was interesting. People go, you know, why did it take so long? Well, first of all, they all take so long. These things are hard. This one took longer than most. But one of the reasons I think is I think there was a lack of understanding that from all those people, studios and financiers who said, oh my God, the greatest story, I saw these people. Whenever we got close to doing it, everyone kind of go, but it's not the Donna Summer biopic. It's about a guy named Neil Bogart. I don't know who that is. I don't know how to now market that. No, but it's got Kiss and and so that became ultimately the roadblock. Every time we got close, it suddenly became clear that people were afraid of the very thing that people were afraid about Neil Bogart. And as the son and as the wife, ultimately that drive and perseverance that he taught, I think, all of us became the thing that did take me down dark alleys and through strange doors and to the pit of despair, you know, starting the movie before COVID, having to shut down for a year, 11 months and 7 days with half a movie, not knowing if COVID was ever going to pass. Not knowing if I would ever be able to complete it. And so at every step, I thought without question, he would keep going. He would keep going. So I think it started with a vision of what I thought was universal, which I thought would make it deeper and richer if we all could really relate to it. Embracing his struggle that became my own and just the pure relentlessness that I was taught I embraced.
Which is amazing to come full circle like that, because the drug thing and the excess stuff, yeah, it's an interesting story to a certain degree, but it's like you would lose the essence of who your father is and what you showed us he is if you would have spent too much time. Because like that's how we are here on Three Sides. Like Michael said, we're not TMZ. We don't care about, we want the minutiae and these interesting things that we don't know about, because we're the kids sitting in the bedrooms in the 70s with Alive, listening to the record over and over again and reading the liner notes and learning everybody's name. It's just to become a passion for, I'm speaking for myself, but essentially for all of us, that we do this because we love music and we love to get together as friends once a week, call it dorky, call us nerds, whatever, but we have a good time doing it. And so for me, it's a thrill to have the two of you on to hear these things, because I've known your names for quite some time. And I always wondered, like, I wonder what they thought of this. I wonder what it was like to be a son or to be a wife and be in that environment, it must have been just amazing. So we appreciate you sharing some of that with us.
Amen.
It was amazing.
I have to share. I'm completely blown away, and I apologize for my lateness, but I haven't really spoken much just because I am so enamored right now. As growing up, where people were really into the music, I was so in love with the record label and the production and that part of the business. That's what I actually went to school for. Mm-hmm. But as a female, and Joyce, this was one of the questions I had for you. As a female, it's unheard of, especially, you know, I graduated high school in the 80s, went to college and graduated in the 90s. And for a female to be in a record business or in production was completely unheard of. So I look at you, Joyce, and I'm completely mind blown, because I look at Nancy and I look at you and I think, wow, these two women had such an important role in the record label and in production and music. I am just completely blown away.
There were very, very few. When Neil says the thing, I had never met anything like her, anybody like her. Yeah, there wasn't anybody working. You know, this thing Monday night I'm doing is with this organization. There are like 20,000 women members in the, you know, in the recording industry. And I think, wow, if I started that organization, there would be five, you know, like Suzanne DePass and me and, Florence Greenberg and, you know, Sylvia Rowan came later. I mean, there's a bunch of them, but there was maybe one promotion person that we had that was a woman. Neil's head of PR and a couple of, besides Nancy, there was one in the field that was really unusual.
I mean, it was very unheard of to see a woman in that type of position back then. I mean, and even in the 90s, it was unheard of, but my God, in the 70s, it was just, you know, mind boggling. So like you and Nancy, you guys were like my heroes, you know?
Joe Smith, who was our own version of Don Rickles, used to be these huge events, and there'd be a dais of 100 guys, everybody in their little tuxedos. And he would always joke and say, look, you see how diversity has really made a difference? You know, not funny, but it was true. There was not one woman up there.
Yep.
You know, crazy. And it was a very different time. But, you graduated when, 80?
I graduated high school in 80 and I graduated college in 90. I wanted to be an entertainment accountant. And for that, a female entertainment business, it was like, yeah, Lisa, we know you're smart and we know you can do it, but it's to be in that kind of business at this time is not going to, it's not going to work, which was kind of like,
but the whole world was kind of like that. You know, I was in television production. I could only be there because, you know, Bill got me into the guild. We were that unit, you know, that lying unit of protection.
I love it. I think
that got us, you know, that got us there. So that, by the time the record business thing, I mean, nobody really cared that he was okay. It didn't matter, you know.
But at the time, like you said, it did. I mean, protecting you. Yes. You know.
Yeah, my son just said to me, you should write the book, Mom. Because, you know, in advertising, that whole Mad Men era, that's when I worked there. Mm-hmm. So you know what was going on then. I lied and said I didn't type. So I couldn't be in the typing pool. I worked for the producer and and that's how I got started. I made no money, but I didn't have to sit there and type and not do anything. But that's where they put all the women.
Absolutely.
Because we all knew how to type. They knew we knew how to type. We took it all in high school, you know, every good boy. But no, I said,
you're like my hero, Joyce. I don't know what to tell you. You guys like shaped my whole love of.
We didn't know what we were doing. My daughter in college was taking a women's studies class, you know, which everybody, and she called me and said, were you influenced by the women's movement? And there was silence on my end of the phone. And she went, you were the women's movement. I said, yeah, but we didn't know we were a movement. We had birth control pills. We had a college education, you know, and I was.
Life is good.
Life is good. I was going out, and living in the West Village. My parents were really upset, but, you know, because I was sent to college for my MRS, which is why you went there in my era. I graduated in 1967. Probably you guys weren't even born then, but
65.
Oh, 64.
There you go.
21. I'm the.
You know, women couldn't have credit cards. I could do nothing without my father or another man signing for me. And at really good restaurants, there were no prices for the women on the menus. How do you take someone out for business for that? My job was to get people from the advertising agency when Bill and I had a company to buy in that we were going to direct their films. I had to go and, you know, make a deal with the guy, with the waiter beforehand. I was like,
I always wanted to be that woman that survived in a man's world, because I just thought that was just so ballsy, you know? When I graduated in the 90s, even that was completely unheard of. So for you to be a woman in a man's world at that point in time is just spectacular. And look at me now. I'm like the only female in a podcast.
There's truth to that. I never thought about that before, but you're right.
Yeah.
See? You know, yeah. That's just so crazy to me that it took this long. You know, because either you can do the job or you can't. It shouldn't matter what, you know, sex you are.
We're going backwards a bit here as a country. You know that, right?
Yeah. I got older sisters who would beat the crap out of me. So it's like
I keep Tommy.
Well, there too. Yeah.
Tim, Joyce, thank you so much for spending all this time with us. And, you know, we didn't mention it a lot, but everybody, Spinning Gold, you have to go see this movie. March 31st, it opens nationwide. And yes, this is a fascinating movie about a man who, again, I'm going to go back to what I said, a man who created the soundtrack for our lives. You didn't realize it when we were kids back in the 70s. But now you know it now, and this is a fascinating movie into the life of Neil Bogart. And that's all I can say. It really does a fascinating job telling us who Neil was. And again, he was the guy who got us Kiss, who got us Donna Summer, who got us the Village People. I mean, Parliament. He was Parliament. I mean, he was the label that brought to us all that amazing music.
Yep. True.
The land of broken toys.
Well, thank you guys. Really, really appreciate it.
Thank you guys.
We can't thank you enough. I mean, you guys shared so much with us, and it means a lot. It means a lot.
Please, both of you, come back. Seriously.
Sure.
Absolutely.
Give me more than 5 minutes notice.
Oh yes.
we will
definitely.
Exactly.
I looked at my thing and it said, and I thought, what time did he, because I wasn't looking at it. Oh, it was 4 minutes ago. Okay. Well, you know.
Exactly. Well, we appreciate it.
We appreciate you dropping everything to do it.
I know you're going to be on, Joyce, and I was running late. And when I logged on, I don't know if you saw my face. I was like, And I messaged the guys. I was like, oh my God, Joyce is on here. It's like, Joyce, I think my head's going to explode. My head is going to explode. Seriously. I was like speechless. I didn't know what to say.
Where are you located? Are you in LA?
I'm in Georgia.
Oh, well, okay. So you can't.
I'm in San Francisco.
That's okay.
Tommy's in Minnesota, and Mark is in Detroit.
See how this music connects you all.
Oh, that's amazing. Well,
yeah, I mean,
well, that's how we met one another. Just so you guys know, we all would travel to Kiss Expos, and that's how we met one another. So it's your fault.
Did you go to the one? There was one in LA that Brad dragged me to, and it was, he said, Kiss is going to play acoustically without makeup.
That was the official Unplugged.
The official convention tour.
Right.
But before, see, that's the whole thing. Gene and Paul.
It was like an offhand thing. They had asked Peter to come in, and I thought, oh my God, the group is back.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what kind of got them back together again and back on tour.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
No, Gene. Gene kept them alive in his garage. He had these metal racks that went like this, and they'd be like little things of slots. And he was selling all the Kiss merchandise from his garage for a couple of years when they had, he won't tell you that story. I would. I pick up thing. What are we selling here, Gene? Oh, that's the, you know.
Yeah.
Right.
I probably have some of it here. That's how they stayed
alive. And you know what else was interesting too, is the four of us all have different passions of the band. You know, like, you know, everybody has their different loves. Like Mark collects a lot of fantastic things. Mike worked with them. Tommy is a collector too. But like for me, I was totally fascinated by the documentation piece. Like that was my collecting, like old contracts, old, you know.
Lisa's got stacks of old coin management memos and documents. And
I have some rock steady ones I could probably give.
That's
them.
My
management contract with them. My rock steady management contract with them. I know I still have that one. All right. Well, we'll talk.
Thank you so much again to both of you.
Thank you both. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful weekend, both of you.
You too.
Thank you. Thank
Tim,
thank
I'm
you.
Sure we'll be in touch.
Absolutely. And thank you for supporting the movie.
Thank you we're so all much, for it. Both of you. Thank
fantastic.
You.
Fantastic.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.
Thank you.
Three Sides. I don't know what to say other than I think we all agree that was probably the greatest interview
ever.
We've done
bar
in
none.
10 years.
Bar none. That was the best episode ever.
I'm a fangirl.
Matter of fact, where's the mic? Drop mic. We're done.
Drop the mic. We're the
last
one.
This is our last episode.
No, don't say that, Tommy. Everybody will be like, yeah.
Oh my God. I don't even know.
Speechless. I mean, the fact that Tim just out of the blue said, would you like Joyce to join us? Yeah.
My heart stopped when he said that. And
just so you guys have context, we were only scheduled to speak with Tim. And just before hitting the record button, we were having some chats between Mark, Tim, and myself while we were waiting for Tommy and Lisa to show up. And Tim goes, would you like me to see if Joyce wants to join this interview? And honest, I don't know if you could see it, but I'm sure both Mark and my eyes went like a cartoon, you know, and jaws dropped and tongues rolled out. And
keep in mind, I don't think she's spoken to anybody publicly about Kiss in like forever.
If you think about the stories, that's not if you think about her and how she started with Bill, right? But then, you know, Mary, like it ended up with this relationship with Neil. It's like the universe is merged, you know, and kissed them.
I'm still
on a high right now.
I am too. I mean, it's just immense thank you to Tim and Joyce for sitting down for nearly 2 hours and just
and Michael,
talking so much.
Guys, the four of us gushing over the movie is not bullshit.
It's not. It's legit.
Good.
It is that good.
Oh, my God.
It's a great.
I've watched it, I think, 10 times, and I bet you there's a way. I was going to ask Tim. I bet you there's a way for him to track how many times I watched that movie.
I mean, I got to stress once again, do not go into this thinking you're going to watch a Kiss movie, a Kiss documentary. This is about Neil Bogart, where Kiss is a part of Neil Bogart's life, just like there's significant Donna Summer. There's significant Parliament. You know, even pre-Casablanca, there's significant story in there. It is a fascinating story about Neil Bogart and his entire life, all of the labels he worked through. So watch it with that perspective. Don't be the geeky Kiss fans who are like, oh, no. That was inaccurate. You know, movies no good. No, that has nothing to do with this story.
Let me tell you, it was well acted. The emotions it brought out. This is a touching, wonderful story about a unique genius. I mean, just his lust for life. Oh, my God.
you know what? One of the things that he said at the very end, if you watch at the very, very end, and he goes, when he's talking, doing the monologue, you know, at the end, he says, you know, it was the soundtrack of your life. He goes, and you probably heard of Donna Summer and Parliament and, you know, and Gladys Knight, he goes, and a Kiss. And he goes, but you know what? Probably never heard of me. And I thought that, you know, that's a very true statement, because you can ask anybody, you know, Donna Summers. Oh yeah, absolutely. But nobody really knows the man behind all of that. And right. To me, that was the most important thing. As I said earlier, that he was like my inspiration. I mean, at a very young age, when you're 7 years old, how the hell do you know who Neil Bogart was? I did. I totally knew who he was, and I knew everything about him at that young age. So, you know, that's what this whole movie is about. And it's so well written, and it's so well produced, and it's such an amazing story. But like you said, Michael, if you go into it as a kids geek, that's not how you're supposed to go into this movie. You know, you kind of have to back away and look at it as Neil Bogart, the person, and what an absolutely fantastic man and innovator that he was.
He was really like, he reminded me of Gene Wilder and Willy Wonka. We are the dreamer of dreams. We, you know what
that's
I mean?
Perfect. We're the risk yes. taker.
That was very good.
Thank you. But that's honestly how I felt watching it, because I've always gravitated towards those people. I love fearless people. I love that.
Don't take no. Don't tell anybody that you can't make your dreams come true.
And what else? Remember at the end, remember that one scene where the sprinklers came on? And it was so funny because he said, we didn't, and he was sitting at his desk. So
I know exactly what you're doing.
And he's like, yeah, I didn't take into consideration the smoke. Or the fire, or the flash pots, or whatever he goes, or the sprinklers.
That was the scene where he then dances with his little daughter. Mm-hmm. Which
the huge shit show that came out of it, that was not was important to him. That was
his daughter.
And the next day, you notice he goes back in the office. He's like, okay, let's go. Nothing let him down. He just kept going. And like, he never was like, oh, woe is me. It's like, he just kept going and nothing stopped. He's like, okay, well, you know, this is what happened. And, you know, Kiss was doomed before they even hit the stage. But here, let's do this. Let's get nothing. He never was like, poor me. Never poor me. Which I thought was absolutely amazing.
Amen. You know,
I gotta remind people, watch the movie all the way through the end of the credits.
Oh, yeah.
Because there is stuff that goes on during the credits.
I have tissues.
That you're gonna wanna watch. So again, stay there until the lights come up and the film has stopped.
Think about it. At the Marvel movie where you have to watch till the end because there's pieces of this you've got to watch.
I tell you what, I cannot wait to take Liz and go and see this on the big screen.
You know what? It's not playing anywhere near me.
Really?
It is not. The closest it is about 40 minutes away.
Really?
You're unwilling to drive that far for this?
I'm going to go. Okay. You know, I thought about it, and I was like, you know what? I really do want to see it on the big screen, because if I
can do too.
It's on my computer, I really want to watch it on the big screen.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
It was
You know, I don't know if we need to give homework. Just tell us what you
see the movie.
See the movie. Yes. Let us know what you thought of the movie.
Yep.
I can only hope that the vast majority of our listeners are like us after you're done watching this interview. This was truly an honor to have.
Oh my God,
Tim Bogart and Joyce Biawitz.
Doesn't get cooler than this.
They look so great. Oh my God,
nice people.
Those are just people. You know, if you just ran into them in the street, you'd go, "You're cool." You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They were just wonderful people.
I want to have coffee with them.
Like, I'm the same way. That's how I'm feeling, Lisa. Like I said, I got there. I'm like, I want to go hang out with them. They're just wonderful people.
Yep, that's exactly.
I mean, I hope we all learned a little bit more from Tim and Joyce about Casablanca, Neil, and especially Kiss. We tried to gear this much more towards a Kiss discussion.
Right.
Hopefully you learned a little something. I think it was just, it's just an honor that they both sat down and shared their time and their lives with Neil, with us.
Yeah, it was amazing.
Amazing. So
have different perspectives too at the same time, you know.
Yep.
Neil, I mean, Tim as a just child witnessing it through his eyes with his father, and Joyce witnessing it first as Kiss's manager and then as Neil's wife. So
yep.
There's so many different perspectives to this.
Oh, there's so much more to talk to her about. They would both come on again. Yeah, because I want to talk to Tim about being a kid and growing up around.
Yes,
I mean, there's so much we didn't get to.
Well, I know. I mean, in my interview with him yesterday for the Music Biz Weekly, he talks about how every day after school, he would immediately just go to the Casablanca offices. And the kids would be hanging out at Casablanca Records all the time. And he would be like, yeah. And, you know, my dad would be like showing us album cover mock-ups and asking us what we think of it. You know, he shared a story. He's like, his dad's like, what do you think of this Love Gun? You know, the Love Poppin' Love. What do you think of this? And he goes, oh, that's pretty cool, Dad.
It's like, cool. Let's do a gun that does things. You know?
Yeah, you know, and you've got to listen to the Music Biz Weekly, because he also shares a story about how his mom, Beth, gave him a violin to learn how to play violin. And then Tim goes to the West Coast, goes into Casablanca. Neil's like, what's in that? Oh, it's a violin mom gave me. And Neil says, wait a second, picks up the phone, calls somebody. Gene Simmons, a little bit later, comes into the office, takes that violin, smashes it against the wall, and gives Tim a guitar and an amp and says, learn to play guitar.
What did he say? I mean, some silver top. Because I
gold
heard it.
Gold
top Les Paul.
Gold top, excuse me.
Gold top Les Paul that he still plays
Brian
to this
day.
I
don't know what that is.
Yeah. So, anyway.
Brian goes,
like one. Thank you for sitting through this interview with us. This was absolutely a moment.
A four-person fanboy.
Yeah, we all went three fanboys and one fangirl.
You've ever seen me go fangirl, ever.
Yeah.
At the Pittsburgh Penguins game with the goalie when he came over.
When she found out the goalie was a Kiss fan.
Yes.
Okay, I don't know. There's nothing more to say. Thank you. Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Joyce. Thanks to all of our listeners for sitting through and joining this episode with us. That's it. Three sides of the coin. We are out of here. Until next week, we got a lot of cool stuff being lined up here. So.
Yeah. It's pretty neat.
If you have something to say, leave a voicemail or send us a text message. Call 320-515-VOICE for Three Sides of the Coin. Provided by LarryDavisVoice.com and by JessicaMarsVoice.com. That's Mars with a Z.